for a moment, if you will, please. We'd like to congratulate Steve and High Energy Enterprises for their new merger with the International Tesla Society. This is going to be a very powerful union. As most of you know, Steve has been the main force behind the Nikola Tesla Museum of Science and Industry. And at this time, we would like to make a presentation to the museum. I have here a copy of an original letter which Nikola Tesla wrote to the board of directors of the Westinghouse Corporation, proposing development of his telegeodynamic system. This has never been public information before, but we'd like to place it in the hands of the Tesla archives for safekeeping and where it belongs. Thank you, Steve. Stay just a minute. Now, the telegeodynamic system was taken up by Walter P. Baumgartner, who spent several years developing the various types of oscillators involved in the system. Walter has brought one of the oscillators today to donate to the museum, and I'm going to ask him now to come and make his presentation and explain to us a little bit what is telegeodynamics. Walter?
I think we should first make the presentation of the unit, and then we can let you go. We would like to give this to the Tesla Museum because it is an apparatus Tesla has worked with for about 40 years. And I will give you a little insight on this for 5 minutes before we go on and do the water slide experiment. So I would like to take this poster here and give that to Steve here, and maybe he can put this up on the wall in your museum, and we'd like to donate this unit to you.
Thank you.
Posted in the library, in the bookstore. Oh, in the library. Okay. All right. Okay. So most people think of Tesla as an electrical genius, but Nikola Tesla also was a mechanical genius, as can be seen from his many patented devices. The device which we are concerned with is what Tesla called his greatest achievement in the field of engineering. It is a mechanical oscillator, which Tesla planned to use in his proposed worldwide system of telegeodynamics, or the art of producing terrestrial motions at a distance. Tesla used one of those oscillators to transmit mechanical vibrations through the Earth and described the movements as a sort of controlled earthquake. The oscillator passed rhythmic vibrations through the Earth with 100% efficiency. And Tesla had visions of these machines being universally adopted for a worldwide unfailing communication system and a system for 100% energy transfer to any part of the Earth. The machine has one of Tesla's favorite qualities: the ability to amplify its own power. It can attain its own resonance and would actually self-destruct if allowed, like the wine glass which bursts when its body is resonated at a certain frequency. An oscillator small enough to put in one's coat pocket caused a small earthquake in Tesla's lab in New York in 1888, which drew public attention. Tesla predicted with this tiny machine and 5 pounds of air pressure, he could topple the Empire State Building in just about a few minutes. A larger machine of moderate dimensions, weighing about 200 pounds, can create pressures of many tons, which are essential for the production of extremely powerful reactions. A larger machine like this will produce a reaction of 10,000 pounds, 200 times per second, which means an accumulated rate of 2 million pounds per second, equivalent to that which might be obtained with 10,000 pounds of dynamite. Tesla's electric generator, patent number 511916 of 1894, where an electric generator is placed on top of the mechanical oscillator, like this here, shows and explains the relationship and interaction of the forces involved. If the oscillations of the reciprocating piston coincide with the oscillations of the electrical system of the generator, then both systems are in resonance. When that happens, minimum energy input is required and maximum output on the generator can be expected. Again, with proper design of conductors reciprocating in the field and considerations given to the solenoid's coils collapsing magnetic field, one can, to put it into Tesla's words, magnify the output considerably. The mechanical oscillations of the pistons are only necessary in order to maintain proper period of the reciprocating system. Minimum air pressure can be maintained, and no matter what the load on the generator, it cannot reflect back onto the piston. The piston, with its applied air pressure, is not the workhorse of the system. The same is true in the case of generating terrestrial motions at a distance. It would be ridiculous to speculate that the piston weighing maybe 1 or 2 pounds can convey the tons of pressures to the ground which are necessary to convey any wave motion at all. In general, the ideal solution is a unipolar magnetic field so determined that the electrical, mechanical, and magnetic systems are always in perfect resonance. This results in an amplification of the oscillations, which, if no safety precautions were made, would go on increasing until the machine is destroyed. So the power of the piston, be it ever so great and variable, can only cause changes in the amplitude. It has no effect whatsoever on the period of the vibrations, which is determined solely by the elastic force of the spring and the mass of the parts set in motion within the oscillator. If, therefore, the amplitude and velocity is changed, it must be accompanied by a great variation of energy. And now maybe just mention a few uses. And using the spherical Earth as a communication system, the spherical shape of the Earth makes a perfect container to amplify and isolate sound vibrations. Therefore, one of the most promising applications of the telegeodynamic oscillator is a worldwide communication system. In our present broadcasting system, or systems, which are based on Hertzian wave concept, attenuation or weakening over a short distance from the source is a constant problem. Repeater stations must be built for periodic reinforcement and boosts of the broadcasts. Also, atmospheric and weather conditions, which change much drastically and so on, interfere with that broadcast in the telegeodynamic communication system. These problems of attenuation, reinforcement at stations and interference would not be considerations. The Earth is the booster station with the waves isolated within the Earth's shape, having its own amplification lenses and reflectors in a natural way. The system would provide an ideal ship and submarine communication at a fraction of the cost of present systems. What is perhaps more important is that it could provide for complete privacy on all communications, depending on modulation and so on. Now, it would be a perfect radar system. The system is non-diminishing because the mother transmitter runs continuously and establishes a standing carrier wave pattern. This pattern also provides a grid for the type of radar which will enable accurate steering of land and sea vessels and under all weather conditions in orthodromic path. That's a word Tesla used. And computation of distance from any place of reference. By the impulse of the transmitter, submarine, sunken ships, submerged icebergs, dangerous rock formations can be readily located. Now, next thing would be very important is that mapping of the interior of the Earth. To geologists, perhaps the most welcome application of teleoscillators will be the precise determination of the constitution and physical properties of the entire planet, for these vibrations penetrate thoroughly every cubic inch of the planet's mass. Now, the standing wave pattern, the mechanical vibrations of the Tesla oscillator produce continuous standing wave patterns, where readings can be done 24 hours a day. The machine is less costly to build and operate, and it's not a destructive force of operation. The oscillator can integrate with the technical facilities available in geophysical work today. The geophones, recording equipment, generators, and amplifiers of geological survey crew today could readily integrate in the sonic system of Teslas. Another major potential of the telegeodynamic oscillators is the development of a worldwide system of power transmission based on the principle of resonance. Millions of receivers accurately tuned and adjusted to resonance with the frequency of the sonic transmitter would receive enough energy to drive a rather unique type of generator utilizing a very small amount of energy due to its unusual construction. The present-day geophones used in seismic work are constructed to sense and vibrate to mechanical and sonic vibrations. They basically consist of a weight on a spring, which begins to bob up and down when they come into resonance at a certain frequency. If the weight was a magnet and surrounded by a coil, it could generate electric current in the usual manner of cutting lines of force. Thus, this unique adaption design for a new generator could utilize the mechanical transmitted power of the telegeodynamic oscillator for electrical power production at any point on the Earth's surface by literally plugging into the Earth. Those are some of the uses this oscillator exhibits, and I hope one day the system will be taken up. We have worked with that system for many years and brought it to this stage, state, and we hope that maybe on a larger scale, it can be adapted and picked up by people who have the means and can actually initiate a system like this. So I hope this will be done soon. Meanwhile, it will be in the Tesla Museum, and you can read the letter of Tesla's when he proposed the system to the Westinghouse of people in 1936. The letter was hidden for a while, and we just accidentally found it about 10 years ago, and we built the whole system practically from that letter. Thank you very much. We go on now to our water thread experiments, and maybe Reda will give us an introduction to it, and I will explain the unit then and what it is here for.
Okay, now we're going to go on with the Wasserfaden experiment. In a few minutes, we're going to turn the lights out, and we're going to demonstrate the electrical potential found in a very minute stream of water by lighting up neon bulbs and vacuum tubes. And we would ask you please to stay seated And if we have the opportunity later, we can have small groups around the device and you can experience it and the shock. But so that everyone can see, please. We have plans available for the apparatus if you wish to build it and perform it yourself, so contact us afterwards. And now Walter's going to describe the apparatus and give you an idea of what to look for, what you should expect to see.
Okay, we have to change this thing over here again.
I've made up a little poster here, so which explains the field which surrounds this water thread as it comes down. The idea of the water thread experiment is to show that we can discharge the water's electrical potential by pressurizing it and forcing it through very fine nozzles at a speed which the water attempts to slow down. The electrical potential is drawn off inductively by the two copper coils. They are actually the collectors of the charge emanating from the water stream. There is a copper plate in each of the containers connected to the opposite container. So on this poster here, we're trying to show the stream of the water and its electrical field around. This is the collector here, the spiral collector over there, and this up here is the nozzle, and this is the water stream as it comes down and splits up. With comparatively minimum velocity, the water runs into those containers there. The small water particles from the split up beam move in tracks and curves of the field around the stream. Most of the water continues towards the catch basin, but tries to avoid it by spreading out as much as possible, by forming a wet ring of around 2 meters in diameter on the bottom. Other particles reverse that direction and actually move upwards by being drawn into the structure of the field. A few drops are trapped by the field and move around the electric wires in spiral path. Some move clockwise, some move counterclockwise. Some move upwards, some move downwards. Some water drops even climb above the spray nozzle there, moving in a spiral fashion around the nozzle to be caught either by the water stream or to settle down on the nozzle itself. An electroscope hooked up to either collectors immediately shows potential, which can be in the excess of 20,000 volts, depending on your water source and how many chemicals or detergents would really kill the effect. And small amount, detergents are, they just offset this whole thing, and you have no indication whatsoever. But I think we can actually start preparing and show you how this will work. Have we got those posters taped up by any chance? Oh, we have one. Okay.
Look at this.
Okay. And take this along? Guess so, huh? Yeah. All right. Now, first of all, we have to see how dark we can get it in here, because the darker it is, the better we see that effect. And I'm going to just, for the experiment first, let it start running. As you can see, they're very fine nozzles. And
hitting the foil.
Pardon?
Hitting the foil.
Yeah. Now, just to begin with, before we put the light out,
You will notice when I touch this collector here, I get shocked, and you will see a difference in the stream because I short-circuit it now. And when I release it, you will see the stream splits up much more, releasing the electrical potential. You have a build-up of potential along the stream here. It's inductively taken off, as it's called the rip zone, where it's taken off and then conducted into those wires and led to the opposite container. So it is one way to show 100% all the electrical potential in the world. Now, can we turn off the light for a moment? And then as much as possible, of course, this one here, which is very important. And maybe we have to turn off that TV tube where it says off. There's still light in the center there, and we have to close that door. That door needs to be closed over there. There's too much light coming in because it cannot see this effect. And depending on the water, you can recognize a little. Yeah, the door cannot be closed more. Huh? It's really now a way of having additional light. I think you can start seeing it, the tube lighting up just a little bit now in my hand. The red is holding over the other one. I don't know if you can see it from the back there, but I wish we could close that door. That would really be of help. Anyhow, I'm holding the neon bulb right into the stream. Well, as long as that is. Maybe somebody can stand in front of it too, so that will help. Yeah, okay. I don't know, can you see this light flickering in that tube? It's either you, Red, or I have to do it for now. And we also have evacuated tubes, which you will see a very faint glimmer in it. And I don't know, can you see it, recognize it, at least in the front there?
Yeah.
And I'm holding it closer to that rip zone now, and you will see it lights up more. And or now I'm holding it directly under the collector, and you can see where it's connected up. There's more a discharge going to my tube. Then now this is a bot here, and you can see it's much stronger. And it's contrary to all electrostatic experiments. The more you have it in the water, the more pickup you have. Whereas in an electrostatic experiment, you will not. There, it's now coming better. Can you maybe try yours over on that side, above the rip zone maybe too, and see if we can have maybe. Well, yeah, see, it lights up better. And if you hold it, put it up like a first thing there, and this side goes in there. Now we are approximately looking at maybe 10,000 volts. I would say, depending how much the water is polluted and how much it has been pressurized. We're doing the opposite of what Schauberger intended to do with all water. You have to centripetally move it. We are pressurizing it, and we're moving it, so to speak, centripetally, and this is why we have this discharge coming out of the from the water. Like when you move pipes, water through pipes, pipes which are in the ground, in water systems. This electricity, like this one here, is conducted into the earth. This is, so to speak, the life force, and this is what you need for all biological systems in order to maintain the your system. So when you make water, you have to make sure it will load up with this potential and is highly charged. Before you drink it, but 100 years ago, you could have that in the up in the mountains and the mountain spring. Maybe it's still available, hardly. But I think we have forgotten what really good water is. And too close. Okay. All right. Fine. So basically, that is the experiment, and we try those tubes here too, but. They light up. See, even the surrounding also charges up. As you can see, the field sometimes goes really far out, and, or when you leave it, see, when I put it down like this, and when you're in the laboratory, all metal objects really charge up, and to the extent it really gets sapped at times.
Here's the tube.
Oh, that's the tube. Okay, now this is an evacuated tube, and there's nothing in it except just a few air molecules, I guess. Let me see here now, if it does anything at all. If we wouldn't have this light effect from that door, then sometimes you can see a very bluish light, and then depending on the water, oops, let me hook it under here. With a neon bulb, you have a gas, and it excites easier than with just an evacuated fuel. No, I guess not. And the water, I guess, is just not that potent. We used to have workshops all over the United States, and it was interesting to notice in different cities and what the water was like. And the best one we found was in Hawaii, where they have a real good water source and the least unpolluted. And those bulbs really lit up with a bluish light over there. So,
that's where to see the field.
The field? Oh yeah. And now we're gonna put some light stream onto the field, and so you see that spray around. And when you really watch it, let me maybe do it this way, not the shine. And you will see the particles returning upwards. They're actually levitating upwards. I can see it from here now when I light up against the stream. And like it is shown on the poster, which I showed earlier, you will see those particles coming up and trying to return to the nozzle. Now, maybe from down here, if you're sure. I don't know if you can really see it. Let me know if you do. Can you see how the all the particles also move not just straight up, they move spirally? Yeah, and way up on top there, I can see them really curling past by the collector. And you see, when you look at those drops at the collector underneath, they accumulate there by the particles coming up against it and actually levitating up there. So the water becomes, in its charge, or pardon me, in its discharge, it wants to return to its source, so to speak, by charging up as it flows down, because it has free path of flow, and that is centripetal, more than centrifugal. And that will make this levitating effect. In other words, when you have water contained in flow pipes and you really have high velocity and centripetal motion, then you, of course, the effect increases almost indefinitely, and you can have power systems and levitating effect like on a larger scale. And as Schauberger explained, you have, for instance, 1 liter of water. And if you if you're able to charge it up and bring it up to a high charge, then you'll be able to lift with 1 kilogram of water 1,000 kilograms into space just by levitation, and the properties of the water would increase considerable. So anyhow, that's the basic idea. I think we have to move on, because there's a lot of things to be said yet. And I hope you've seen some of those effects here, especially. I can see it here from that lamp easy, but I don't know how you've been able to see it.
See the water way out here, the field?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And if you would, and you can see all those particles curling around, and when you really look and observe it for a while, it takes a while to really figure out and see it thoroughly, but we had all kinds of lighting on those lighting effects, and where it shows up more or less. Okay, now maybe we have shut this off up here, and we can put the light back on there. Yeah?
It's just a...
Okay, I'm giving you the...
We'll talk about it a little bit. Okay.
Thanks. How many of you could see it in the back? Could you tell the neon lights were good? Okay. Now let's talk about the significance of what you just saw. We just saw a 5 millimeter thread of water under normal tap pressure, approximately 30 psi, deliver slightly under 10,000 volts. Now this, we've run this experiment in various cities across the United States, as Walter said, and the apparatus can give us a measure of the bioelectric content of water. It can also test water's quality. Now there's a direct relationship between the electrical content of water and water's state of health. And there's a direct relationship between the state of health of water and the state of health of every bioorganism that utilizes the water. So the cities that we have tested have ranged from San Francisco, California, which only showed about 5,000 volts, and they would barely light the neon bulbs, to Oahu, Hawaii, where we measured about 12,000 volts. And of course, the brilliance in the tubes would correspond with the lower or higher potential. Now the cities, the difference in the voltage is a direct reflection of how the water has been treated physically and chemically. San Francisco's water is pumped centrifugally over a long distance, sometimes in open channels, and it's heavily treated with chemicals for purification. And Oahu's water was from a local artesian well. However, it was treated with chemicals also. And if we compare those voltages with the voltage that you can measure from a mountain spring, we find that the mountain spring can deliver up to 60,000 volts. That's quite a difference. There's other differences also. There's a difference in the gaseous content, in the mineral content, in the temperature of the water, and in the density. And all of these factors reflect back on water's capability of holding that electrical potential. Now, if we ran distilled water through this Wasserfaden apparatus, we would have no electricity delivered. The neon bulbs will not light because distilled water has been stripped of its mineral and chemical content. Hopefully, that's what distillation is for, and depending upon how good your unit is. And so, therefore, it cannot make an electrolytic solution. But distilled water can be recharged with electrical content by a vacuum synthesis process, which we'll talk about in just a minute. A question often asked about this experiment is, why does the water break into the distinctly layered field? So all bodies of water, whether they are still or moving, come in laminar layers, strata. And each of these layers has a different potential, a different density, and a slightly different temperature. And each of the layers has a boundary between it. It has an indifferent zone, a neutral zone. And that zone serves the function as a cell membrane or our skin. For it both insulates the potential differences between the layers and it regulates the exchange or the conduction that happens between the layers. And the outside layers of either on the surface of a still body of water or those next to the pipe or the channel of a moving body of water have a lower electrical potential, a higher temperature, and they're less dense. They're constantly being discharged through friction. And as we approach the central layers of water, we will find that they have a higher potential. They have a lower temperature, which approaches the optimum temperature of a plus 4 degrees Celsius, and they are much denser. And depending upon what conditions the water is subjected to, that electrical potential can be contained in the water, it can be held, it can be recycled and recharged, stepped up to a very high potential. Now, in the Wasserfaden experiment, we are discharging the potential for the sake of showing that there is a bioelectric content in water. We're subjecting the water to all of the negative or detrimental conditions so that it cannot contain its electrical content. We're subjecting it to centrifugal pumping, diffusion under pressure, oxidation, temperature rise, and molecular disintegration. We are splitting apart the laminar layers so that it will release its capacitance. Now this water, if it's consumed after running through the Wasserfaden experiment, has very little life energy to deliver to a biosystem. And the detrimental conditions that are in the Wasserfaden experiment are exemplary of those that are found in our conventional water treatment systems. And in addition, the water treatment systems of most municipalities add chemicals, poisonous chemicals, to treat and kill bacterial action, which is only a reflection of the poor state of health of the water in the first place. So unfortunately today, most people are drinking and bathing in either poisoned or dead water. We're feeding it to our plants, our animals, and our families. And don't think I'm just talking about a few isolated cases, because there have been surveys done in all of the U.S. states and their territories and compiled showing that there are 2,100 contaminants in our drinking water supply since 1974. Now the EPA has regulations on very few of these. Most of them have never been studied for their long-term harmful effects. And in the early 1900s, Victor Schauberger began warning us of the consequences of improper water treatment. He predicted the decline in our agricultural productivity, the loss of our rivers and streams, the loss of our vegetation, our forest, and our animal species, and the rise in cancer and genetic deficiencies. He said they would occur parallel with our misunderstanding of the nature of water and our mistreatment of it. Now, he not only presented the doomsday predictions, he gave us a very extensive insight into the character of water. And he engineered and constructed devices which could maintain and uplift the quality of water while at the same time drawing electrical potential and mechanical power from the water. And he showed us such an abundance that had never been accomplished before. He taught that we should look at nature and copy the centripetal motion of cycloidal movement. Now, one such device that Schauberger copied nature's process of making spring water is this unit on this side of the table called the vortex water spring. We have duplicated that unit, and it duplicates the process that occurs in the geosphere where water is enriched and made potent before it levitates itself as a spring. Schauberger called this mature water, ennobled water. It's highly charged with bioelectricity, and it's ready for consumption. Basically, the process consists of special mineral catalyst and carbon dioxide gas being linked molecularly to the water in a hermetically sealed egg-shaped container through a vacuum synthesis process. A vortex runs in the urn for approximately 20 minutes, and a 10-inch vacuum of mercury occurs, and the whole process is done at 4 degrees Celsius. This unit makes approximately 1 gallon of water in 20 minutes, and it makes water comparable to that of a high altitude mountain spring. We now manufacture these devices, and we have a video available which shows the process, and if you're interested, please contact us afterwards. Now let's go back to the Wasserfaden experiment. What else did it show us? That the electrical potential in a very minute stream of water can be drawn off inductively and utilized. That tiny thread of water at a relatively slow velocity delivered so much electricity. And while it was being subjected to the detrimental conditions. Now, Schauberger built machines and proved that water will indeed deliver electrical potential and mechanical power, which could be amplified beyond man's imagination and current technological knowledge, and without destroying the quality of the water. That means without electrolysis, without steam, without molecular disintegration, without taking it apart and burning its parts as fuels. Quite the contrary, the water would be uplifted, ennobled, enriched. He produced a new form of water, which he called polywater. It is different from heavy water. As a matter of fact, he called it light water because it produced his levitating effects. He taught in the 30s and the 40s and the 50s that yes, indeed, water is the new fuel of the future. And he also gave us a non-destructive method to pursue this new technology. Now, our current research at Energy Unlimited is duplicating the works of Schauberger and teaching vortexium mechanics. And we would invite you, if you are interested in either the vortex water spring or vortexium mechanics, to contact Walter or I during the conference, and we have an information packet available. Thank you. That's it for today. And we're going to entertain questions after they turn the tape off. Okay?